second lecture in the Future of Immunity lecture series. I'm Bernadette Pager, co-president of Informed Choice Washington. Informed Choice Washington is a group of more than 1,000 people. We add numbers every day. We are parents, educators, attorneys, doctors. We have in common that we want to support medical freedom, and we want to work for scientific integrity in vaccination policies. Across the country, there are thousands of medical freedom groups and vaccine safety groups that are working just like us. We add up to millions across the country, and actually across the world. In the past decade, there has been a staggering amount of science on the immune system. From the revolutionary finding of the gut-brain connection to the discovery just 2 years ago that the lymphatic system is directly tied to the brain, and to the epigenetic impact of environmental exposures, which is what Dr. Deischer and Dr. Ben are going to be talking to us about today, it's very clear that the future of immune protection doesn't lie in creating a product for every single germ that industry wants to create a product to target, but it lies in building true individual immune health. The American Academy of Pediatrics acknowledges that parents who space vaccines or refuse vaccines are highly knowledgeable about vaccines. That's all they say. They don't extrapolate. They don't tell you what we know. They just say they're highly knowledgeable about vaccines. Many of them are college educated. Now, here's a script to try to talk these people into getting these things. So what we're here today is to talk about what we know, what the highly educated people about vaccines know that we think everybody should know. So today our focus is genes and vaccines, dirty genes, mutations, fetal DNA. What impact do vaccines have on your genes? Let's find out. So to introduce our first speaker, I want my co-president Drella Stein to come up here. Drella is mom to three awesome boys. She's wife to an amazing published author. You can look up Gart Stein. Okay, a tireless activist for medical freedom and for educating our elected officials. We have spent a lot of time in Olympia. And educating those in public health on current science. I'm very proud to serve alongside Drella on the board. Thank you, Bernadette. Thank you. I am honored to present our first speaker, Dr. Benjamin Lynch. Benjamin Lynch, MD, received his Cell and Molecular Biology Bachelor of Science from the University of Washington and his doctorate in naturopathic medicine from Bastyr University. His passion for identifying the cause of disease directed him toward nutrigenomics and methylation dysfunction. Currently, he researches, writes, and presents worldwide on the topic of MTHFR, methylation defects, and genetic control. You can learn more about Dr. Lynch and his work at his website, drbenlynch.com. Dr. Lynch is the president of Seeking Health, a supplement company focused on disease prevention and health promotion. The website is seekinghealth.com. He lives in Seattle, Washington, with his wife, Nadia, and three boys, Tasman, Matthew, and Theodore. Welcome, Dr. Lynch.
Morning.
Good morning.
Why are you all here on one of Seattle's sunny days? But there is no vitamin D yet. We are living in a vitamin D winter. So as long as there's sun out there, it doesn't mean it's always generating vitamin D. It has to be up high enough in the sky at a certain angle. So just to let you feel a little bit better about being inside, what we know. So yeah, this is a huge topic, and thank you for being here. This is a really huge passion of mine. I'm sick and tired of seeing autism like this, right? I mean, this has got to stop. And your education, your desire, your commitment to this, and every one of you talk to other people, and it starts spreading, right? So, this is a big topic. And since it's a big topic, there's a lot to cover. And I can't cover everything. I don't know everything. So I'm going to stay in my wheelhouse. And what I will say is I'm not a pro-vaxxer and I'm not an anti-vaxxer. I am an integrity vaxxer. I don't know if that's a word yet, but I want to figure out how can we get these things safe so we actually can prevent disease and support people rather than doing it massively. I get public health, I get what they're trying to do, but in my opinion, it's not the right thing to do with what we're doing now. And it's pretty obvious, right? I mean, it really is pretty obvious that it's not working. So, started. I had to start with something like, who's hiked our beautiful North Cascades, right? This is gorgeous. And when I was attending the University of Washington, 1992 to 1997, I was able to hike a lot. And no, it didn't take me 5 years to complete the program. I still completed it in five or four, but I happened to travel the world for a year. End of my junior year, I was sick and tired of being told what to do in a class, and I wanted to expand my own mind, and traveling was the best thing I ever did for a year in South Pacific and Southeast Asia. It was phenomenal. So when we get stressed out, just remember we have this to go towards. I think it's the best way to start. This is a key statement. When I read this for the first time, I was like, wow, that's actually pretty cool. So, nothing has meaning except for the meaning you give it. So, when this individual says that vaccines are safe and aluminum is fine because it's the third most plentiful compound on the planet and vaccinate away, that's his meaning. Okay? And then you have Dr. Suzanne Humphreys who says something totally different. So we are applying meaning, and I think one is way more credible than the other. There's conflicts of interest, there's lack of digging in the research, or just ignoring the research. So I think this is a really important point. And here's the same individual who is holding an infant at the same time saying that aluminum is an essential nutrient. Right there on his website, which has been since removed. But he was saying aluminum was an essential nutrient. I know of no enzyme or gene in the entire human body that uses aluminum on its own desire, at will, as a cofactor in order for function. In fact, it does the opposite. So I'm always looking for mechanisms of action, meaning I'm looking for things which make our genes work better or make them work harder or not as smart, you know, as well as they should be. And so I have the fortunate of working with other great people like Dr. Paul Thomas, who wrote the amazing book, The Vaccine Friendly Plan, Dr. Judy Mikovits, who was doing all sorts of work and research on rotaviruses and found all sorts of harmful things about them. So collaborating with these professionals is great. And so we have to keep going and look for mechanisms so we can identify these problems before we vaccinate. So it's, you know, get that. So these are some labs that I came up with very quickly, thinking if we ran labs in infants or in pregnant women and we found problems in these, then maybe we shouldn't vaccinate. So I'll go through these as we progress today. So this is the current schedule, according to our CDC, and according to Dr. Paul Thomas in his vaccine-friendly plan, he has removed hepatitis B from his population and has noticed that they are not really getting autistic. So hepatitis B is a big one. And I'm not sure the exact year hepatitis B was starting to give at birth. I think it was around 2001. I'm not sure. But it didn't used to be this early. It didn't used to be at birth. The last time I checked, infants weren't having sex. So And then you have also very low incidence of women or, you know, pregnant mothers with hepatitis B themselves. So it doesn't make sense to me. So anyway, I just wanted to show you this. You've probably seen it a million times, but that is something that Dr. Paul Thomas is pretty against, vaccinating with hepatitis B at birth, and you have to protect your child. Even if you say you opt out, the nurses are so used to the routine of vaccinating that even if you wrote opt out, and not by any malicious assault, they're just used to it. It's a habit. So they just go, you know, your baby's born, they'll walk over, place it on the table, they'll check it out and do all their things, and they'll just vaccinate immediately. So you have to stand guard. Sounds odd, but you have to stand guard. HPV is another one, and the flu shot is another one. So we are 99% genetically identical. All of us, basically, are about 99% having the same genes. That's pretty cool. So we have a 0.1%, 1% genetic variation, meaning how our genes work. There's polymorphisms, there's variations in how our genes work, born that way, and they're set with their genetic code, and that is kind of our variation. And that slight variation determines our skin color, our neurotransmitters, our ability to mobilize toxins in and out. So, you know, our ability to fall asleep, stay deep sleep. If we eat asparagus, our pee stinks. I mean, you know, these are the random variations that are among all of us. So what public health is trying to do is say, hey, let's take something that's singular and whack it. So it's medicine. Conventional medicine is like literally a game of whack-a-mole. You have a headache, you take an NSAID, right? You have pain, you take an anti, you take a Nervine or what have you. Or if you have gastric reflux, you take an antacid. You have a bacterial infection, you take antibiotics. See where I'm going? So now we have diseases, and let's take a vaccine to prevent these diseases. Well, these are all super, super reductionist. The body doesn't work this way. We got totally amazed with the power of antibiotics, and they work. Well, they used to work really well, but they still work well. But I want to say that I'm really, really cautious against this reductionistic thinking. And I'm going to show you some diagrams that might put you a little bit backwards, but the body is inherently beautiful. It's never inherently trying to kill us, and it has multiple backup routes. Otherwise, we would have been dead as a species a long time ago. Right? So, this is a great statement. If we are intellectually honest, that's a good start, we must discard old ideas and look for new paradigms to explain the cause of symptoms of the disease if we test a rationally designed therapy in patients with the disease, but it fails repeatedly. Okay? So, we have to constantly look for new ideas, get rid of the old ones, and if we think something is rational and it's well designed but it keeps failing, then it's time to maybe change a little bit, right? So I think we're there with vaccines. I think we're there. And, you know, I think the two camps of anti-vaccine and pro-vaccine are making it really easy for our government officials and our CDC officials, because we're the ones fighting against each other, and they just sit back and do nothing because we're the ones constantly arguing with your friends and family and doctors. They just let us continue to bicker, and they don't have to do anything. So we have to come to some middle ground and support each other, because the ultimate goal is to support us and the human species, right? By the way, this is probably one of the best research papers I've ever written. Read. Cell Danger Response by Robert Nabio. It's free, download. So I highly recommend you read this paper. I hope you learned something from me today, but if you don't, you can at least read this paper, and I'll at least pass that on to you. Okay? But this is a phenomenal paper. It's dense. I've probably read it 10 times. I want to read it another 100. But it is really, really good. And I will tell you, vaccines trigger the cell danger response immensely. And basically what the cell danger response is a body's response to a dangerous threat. Whether it's you see something that scares you, whether it's an aluminum adjuvant that's injected into you, whether it's a toxic smell from your neighbor's dryer sheets. Right? So all of these little things stimulate various genes in your body in order to do jobs. And those are cell danger responses. Now, if you get freaked out, are you able to figure out a complex math problem at the same time? No. Your genes are focused on you getting out of there. And you've heard this example many times. So when there's an insult to the body, such as an adjuvant, like aluminum, or human fetal cells, or whatever's in there, then the normal genetic machinery is not going to work as planned. It's dealing with cell danger response. Another classic quote. This is not what standard conventional medicine is thinking about. They're thinking about the disease only. They're not thinking about the patient. You walk in as a patient, they're trying to find an algorithm so they can give you something. So with vaccines, there's not even really an algorithm anymore. It's give the vaccine. The algorithm's completely gone. It's the only algorithm is age. And if you have it, if you have a vaccine or not, that's pretty much it. And that's pretty bad. So what sort of a person are you vaccinating? Is it a very healthy, vibrant young baby with great genes, born genes, you know, that are not inherently dirty from the mom and dad, and not dirty from the environment, and not dirty from being in her womb for 8-9 months, and her having a good, healthy diet? So these are really important questions that we have to think about. Make It Stick is a great book as well. Become capable through learning and development of mental models that allow us to reason, solve, and create. Reason, solve, and create. Is there any reason going on right now? Is there any solving? Are there any solutions being created? No. So you're going to be learning some difficult things today, and when you're learning some things that are difficult, you're doing important things. So the basics, introducing, getting to the model, the basics is we want to have clean genes. We want our genes to be freely available to work when they need to work and respond when they need to respond and having the tools that they need in order to perform the jobs that they do. Genes do work. That's it. Genes do work. That's all you need to know. If you give them the right tools, they can get their work done. If you give them the right tools, but you impede them from getting their work done, they can't get the work done. So we know that these things contribute to our genes functioning well. We all know this. And if we have clean genes, then we have healthy genetic expression, there's a lack of symptoms, and there's a great life. Opposite, our genes get bombarded. And these are the things that dirty our genes and bombard them. These are all known. There's the hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of research papers supporting many different ways of this. Okay? We can look at one gene. We can look at MTHFR itself. We can look at COMT. We can look at glutathione genes. But in general, this is the basic concept that you need to understand. So if you don't sleep well at night, your cellular repair, your growth hormone isn't going to be secreted, and your melatonin isn't going to be secreted, and you're not going to be doing well. Your cortisol will be high. The next day you wake up and you're lethargic, so, and your risk for cardiovascular disease goes up, and so on. So when you have altered gene expression and your genes don't work well, you get symptoms. symptoms don't just appear randomly. Symptoms appear because something's not working properly. And these things, it's something that's not working properly, are your genes. If your genes are not working right, they're not expressing properly, or they're expressing because of something else is causing them to act that way, then you're going to have symptoms. So anytime you have a symptom, I want you thinking, huh, what isn't working quite right? What did I do to initiate this? And what can I do to reverse it? Don't act and swallow a pill. Backtrack in your head. Think, what happened? Who here has taken a child to the pediatrician? Your child was vibrant, doing really well, and had them vaccinated, and then maybe a few days later or a week later, they were not doing well at all. Who's seen that personally? Okay. Who's heard of a friend or a family member? Exactly. Are we all nuts? Are we seeing things that other people aren't seeing? No, these are real. So we have to change this. So your child or your friend's child, their genes were functioning well. There was an assault to their genes, cell danger response occurred, and their baby, that infant, is stuck in that negative cell danger response and they can't get out because the genes are dealing with something. More important than speech, more important than mood, more important than walking and crawling. That is not important to the genes when they are dealing with a massive assault. That's what they're working on. And once that assault is removed, then speech will start happening. Then they'll be starting to grow again. Then they'll be, their moods will be back in order again. Make sense? So we have to figure out what that assault is and what's going on and why are certain people more susceptible to vaccine injury than others. That's it. That's what we need to figure out. So the basic model is this. Substrate is the material that goes into your genes. Okay? Substrate comes in, it'll tell your gene to produce something, that's the end product. So genes will do perform work when they have adequate substrate and they make something. Okay? And genes produce enzymes for the most part. And when the enzyme has a cofactor is a vitamin and mineral. Your vitamins and minerals are cofactors, not aluminum. Aluminum's not a cofactor. Vitamins and minerals are there. So if the infant has a lack of vitamin and minerals and they get vaccinated, then that gene or enzyme wasn't working well in the beginning already. And then a lot of times aluminum works like the purple, decreases the activity of that particular gene. And there's about 18, 19 to 23,000 genes in the human body. Okay? So aluminum is decreasing or altering the gene activity, then we have a problem. And things can also increase the activity. So this is the basic model that can be applied to all 19,000 genes. And then we'll talk about haplotypes. When you start combining gene to gene to gene to gene, and looking at if one gene acts this way, and another gene acts this way, and another gene acts this way, then we are even more susceptible to things like vaccines. So this is an example of someone with a born dirty gene. They inherited a problem gene. I'm going to call it a problem gene just for sake of making it simple, but many, many polymorphisms have been inherited because of natural selection. There are benefits to them. The problem is natural selection occurred because of an insult to our ancestors, and they survived that insult. A natural insult. Now our insults aren't so natural anymore. So these polymorphisms are not really acting the same beneficial way to us as they did our ancestors. I'm not living in England or Slovakia like my ancestors did anymore. I'm in a different environment. And my ancestors, your ancestors, did not have vaccines. either. So, or all these massive environmental compounds. So moving on, this, when you have a polymorphism in this MTR gene, it will slow this gene down. It will slow its ability to work, which means that homocysteine can't get through as fast. Make sense? So if homocysteine can't get through as fast, your production of methionine goes down. If you, the green are the vitamins and minerals that this particular enzyme needs. You need vitamin B12, folate, and zinc for this gene to work. And this purple stuff slows it down. Okay? Lead, mercury, hydrogen peroxide, yeast overgrowth, alcohol, inflammation, medications can slow these things down. Okay? So this is one particular model. And that goes into this become dirty. Most of us, even if we do not have a genetic polymorphism, so if we're born with a not red thing right here, we don't have an inherited polymorphism which naturally slows our gene down, we think we're okay, right? You get your genetic test back, you're like, oh, I don't have this MTR thing anymore. I don't have it, so I'm fine. No, you can be getting these things, the lead, mercury, hydrogen peroxide, which can also slow your gene down. Does that make sense? Are we clear with this?
Yes.
Everybody got it? Anybody not get it? Don't be shy. This is a new model that a lot of people don't get, even practitioners. You all good?
Can you just explain a little bit about homocysteine? I'm sorry, I missed the last.
Yeah. So, yeah, a bit about homocysteine. Homocysteine is a compound in the body which we need, but when it's in too high amounts, it can slow a lot of very, very important processes. It's associated with cardiovascular disease, neurological disorders, free radical production, and so on. So it can be very, very toxic in higher amounts. So I expect you to know all this by the end of the day. So this is what I'm talking about when we need to start getting rid of the reductionist theory, okay? So all these bubbles on here, all these little round bubbles, these are all different genes, okay? And they're not laying flat on a pancake inside of our body. They're all coiled up and communicating and sending signals to other things. So the body is inherently complex. And this is only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 pathways. And there's hundreds more. So when we think that we know what we're talking about, we have no idea. No idea. We can have some general thinking and thought processes and theories which seem credible, and we apply them, we can get results. Yeah, that's great. But science is only accepted theory. That's it. Science isn't really proven. It's accepted theory. So when you zoom in, you can get it a little less Dalton. So MTGFR, who's heard of it? Okay? So this is one gene out of 19,000. I thought it was the gene to focus on. And then I focused on it, and I worked with people with their MTGFR problems, and some got like their life back, others had no change, and others I made worse. So I think, well, I'm going to crack this thing open and see what else is going on. And then when I did that, I figured out that MTGFR wasn't the only gene in the human body. So, there it is. That's the first one I ever looked at. And then I discovered in the research that I was like, oh, there's that one, and then there's these. And I was like, oh, God, what did I start unveiling? So, yeah, I always joke that I opened Pandora's box and I share the misery with you all to join me so I don't feel as bad. But this is one particular gene, which is very, very important, but it's a lot of other important genes too. So it's not just one particular gene. So you can apply that same model which I talked about to every single one of these, which is what has been done on this pathway. Because genetics isn't really what we need to focus on. It's the epigenetics. It's the gene expression. People want, they say, Dr. Lynch, can you write a paper and say that if a patient or an infant has MTGFR that they're medically exempt? It's like, I can't do that. Italians have a very significant MTHFR variation, and they have infants without any neural tube defects. They're fine. Here in the USA, if you have an MTHFR genetic variation, the risk of neural tube defects is really high. So that's environmental. So no, I can't do that. So these are the things that we need to start understanding as well. Dairy antibodies are a very real problem. Dairy antibodies slow this gene down, FOLR1, which is a folate receptor. So you can't get folate into your cell if there's a dairy antibody sitting on the receptor. Folate's coming through the blood, and it wants to dock on the folate receptor. But there's a dairy antibody sitting on it. Can't get in. You remove dairy from the kid, and then the dead antibodies go away, folate goes through the blood, it can bind to the receptor, get inside the cell. Make sense? So there's something sitting there blocking it. So this is what's really, really powerful is when you figure these things out. And by the way, every one of these purple words and green, this is all cited from the National Library of Medicine. And this is not, this is published research. Folic acid also is an issue. So you just keep going and you start looking at all these things, and all these things interfere with genetic expression. Organophosphates, right? See that? Organophosphates? Pretty important to eat organically, because this particular gene right here, TYMS, its job is to make your DNA base, thymine from uracil. If you don't have enough thymine to support your DNA, you're getting RNA in your own DNA. And then the machinery is going to come along and it's come along and say, oh, there's a uracil there, it needs to cut it out. And then it keeps cutting it out because you don't have enough thymines. It keeps putting a uracil in there. Your risk for cancer goes up. And then you keep doing that, and then the genes get brittle. And they can't even work very well anymore. So organophosphates are huge. And there are genes which detoxify organophosphates, which are polymorphic. And one of my sons, Matthew, has a really, really significant gene which reduces his ability to get organophosphates out. So all these purple things are slowing genes down. And these green are the nutrients that you can get over the counter, folinic acid and methylfolate, which are very useful so you can get rid of folic acid. And very briefly, folic acid you should not be taking. You should be using natural folates found in leafy green vegetables, or if you like, liver, which I don't. My wife cooks liver at home sometimes, and I basically have to leave the house. I'm not a fan. I wish the fan would be on when she was cooking it. But it's a very, very good source of liver. Folate. And then you can supplement also with something called folinic acid, which is right here. That's over-the-counter folinic acid or methylfolate. So if you're supplementing now with folic acid, it's okay. Just stop. Your body will wash it out in about a week. If you eat processed foods, you get folic acid, it's okay, just minimize it. Okay, I eat processed food too. I'm not perfect. I eat junk as well. But just try to minimize it. So these genes right here. Okay, so SLC reduces the transportation of folate in the blood by 50%. So when you swallow your food, you think, oh, I'm going to get what I just got and I'm healthy. No. You have to absorb it. You have to transport it. It has to be bound to receptors. The cell membranes have to be intact. It has to get inside the cell. The genes have to be able to communicate and work with each other. And then they can perform their functions. All that has to happen. So this gene right here reduces the transportation of folate by over 50%. That's a lot. So if you swallow your folate supplements or your folate-containing foods, you're half as likely to get folate to your receptor as you need to. And what if you're consuming dairy and you have dairy antibodies? So here you are. Let's say your infant has a folate transport genetic problem, is consuming a dairy-based formula, And you were also taking folic acid, high dose folic acid, all throughout pregnancy because you have recurrent miscarriages. We're just talking two genes. And your entire biochemistry is a mess just from those two things. And how many infants are on dairy-based formula and the mother is on our high-dose folic acid supplements? A lot. A lot. So you remove those two things, and then the mother is also drinking dairy herself and also has folate transport problems. And if the mother has folate transport problems, how's she going to transport folate to the developing baby? Right? So these are real, very real things. And we didn't have all this autism that we have now until, what, 10, 20 years ago? Right? So this is very recent if you look at the human species as a whole. And no diagnoses didn't get better. I mean, yeah, it did, but that's definitely not explaining. And then you've got these genes, the red, which slows down folate as well, coming through. That was the genes of my son, Theo. And he just had a basketball game today, which is I was a little bit late. I was trying to get to it, but I was also refining my presentation. He's a little stud. I'm a proud father of Theo. I don't know if he knocked this boy down or not, or the kid's just admiring his speed and skill. He gets the job done on the field. But I will say that Theo was delayed in speech. He had some difficulty learning, and he would get tics with his eyes. He'd do this a lot, and he would have chronic little coughs clearing his throat. And I also have two other boys, and the oldest is always trying to bring dairy into the home. He wants his dairy yogurt, he wants a dairy ice cream, and Theo is a sneak. He's good at it. And he'll say, "Dad, I have to go to the bathroom." "No, you don't have to go to the bathroom that much." He's doing something in there with candy. He has little stashes in his pockets, but he'll get the dairy, and I know when he has dairy because he does the frequent blinking and gets their little coughing, and then it affects his moods. He gets ticks, and I was like, "Theo, you're sneaking. So he can't cheat, he can't sneak with me anymore because I know the symptoms." And he knows it. He knows it too. So his face will get all puffy. He is fully unvaccinated. He has none. Zero. He was the last boy delivered. My first son, born first year, first quarter, during finals week at best year, I was anxiously pleading with all my professors, "My son is going to be born any day here. What do I do about vaccines?" None of them will give me a straight answer. How many times have you tried that? Gone to your health professional, you've gone to, you know, other educated people and say, "Will you please tell me something about vaccines?" It's like the topic nobody can talk about. It's like, shh. I never got a straight answer. So I fully vaccinated my oldest son with everything. Everything. Thankfully, his genes do not look like that. His genes were way better than Theo's. We got lucky. We got lucky. Plus, my wife had a really great pregnancy with him overall. So, next son, Matthew, he has the gene very, very susceptible to organophosphates. And he has MTHFR like I do. His MTHFR gene is slowed down by 70%. And, you know, but he's doing really well. He's had two vaccines. Diphtheria and tetanus, but they were clean, right? You can order, they were thimerosal free back in the day, and he is now 12 years old. When he was 11, he ran a 540 mile, and this year, in the fall, he ran a 1203 2 mile, so he was the fastest 7th grader out of 6 or 7 schools in cross country. So despite the genes you're born with, as long as the environment is healthy, you're healthy. So, in part of that environment is defined as anything that's not us. Okay, anything that's not us. There's carpet in here, there's air in here that we're, you know, this air in here is actually pretty good. But, you know, the environment is really, really influencing our genes. This looks like the matrix a bit, right? So, when you get your genetic test back, be like, oh God, how do I fix that red thing? That doesn't look good. That's scary. Doc, how do I fix that? And docs don't really know, and they'll say, oh, well, you need to, needs vitamin B6, so you need to take vitamin B6 for it. Oh, but in fact, actually, you know, that gene is slightly faster, so you need to avoid vitamin B6. It's like, wait a minute, I need to avoid, okay, I can't take vitamin B6 because I have that particular gene, but what about all the other genes that need vitamin B6? I'm not gonna, oh, don't worry about that. So, this is what's happening right now. People are getting their genetics, doctors don't know, everybody's reacting out of fear, and they're trying to fix it with a single intervention, which is typically a vitamin or a mineral or a supplement, and it's not working, which is why I wrote that. Because I tried doing it that way too, and I failed miserably with my patients. I was trying to supplement each one of these genes. I thought that you could swallow a pill and it would magically get to those genes and act how I wanted to act, but it backfired big time. So my point with this slide is one, to say you can't just take vitamins for your SNPs, and two, that we are all different. We're all different. Plus, red doesn't mean bad, red means different. Yellow doesn't mean bad, it means different. Are we vaccinating anybody differently? No. Are people's genes different? Yes. Are people's environments different? Are people's pregnancies different? Are people's pregnancies different because their stress loads are different during pregnancy? Their illnesses during pregnancy are different. The environment where they're living in their home, maybe it's mold-free, maybe a woman is pregnant when there's got a lot of mold in her home. That's Seattle, it's a reality. We have mold here. So the health of the pregnancy, the health of the environment, all predispose our genes to getting dirty, plus they can be born dirty. And I want you to pay attention to, there's a few here, and by the way, this is from a genetic report that I've created called Stratagene, and my research team and I have found hundreds and hundreds and hundreds more. And these are all clinically researched from National Library of Medicine as well. So there's peer-reviewed research for each one of these to back them up. And the immune haplotypes, the immune variations are very common in the population. And I'm gonna show you why that's not a good problem. We don't do this. We do not do this. Why not? Why don't we consider vaccines like any other medication? I'm not going to go to the doctor and they're not going to give me insulin. My blood sugar's fine. They're not going to give me Ritalin. My concentration's pretty good. Sometimes I need it, but usually I don't need it. Okay? Not everybody needs an SSRI. Not everybody needs an antacid. Maybe not everybody needs a vaccine. But yet, we do it for every single one, especially in the state of California. It's ridiculous. This line of thinking has got to stop. Warfarin. They started doing genetic testing now for warfarin because some people have the ability to process warfarin very quickly and other people process it really slowly and people would bleed out and die in a hospital. Well, I think autism, the kid isn't dying, but in reality, they're really struggling. Really struggling. It's not death, but it's pretty bad. So I don't know what it's going to take to get this change, besides us coming together on a beautiful sunny day to learn about it and to get the word out. So thank you all for what you guys are doing. Adjuvants. So, you know, you guys generally know that adjuvants are designed to increase inflammation so the immune system will be woken up when the vaccine is given, right? So the adjuvant's job is to stimulate the immune system. Well, what if the immune system is already stimulated in the baby strongly? I'm going to show you that that could be a problem. So aluminum is not the best. I mean, they pulled out thimerosal from most of them. They did not pull thimerosal out of the multi-dose flu vaccine, which now you can drive in everywhere. I see flu shot signs all over the place, and they're driving me crazy. So this I pulled from a slide from Dr. Suzanne Humphreys. So I posted this video last night on my Facebook page. Dr. Benjamin Lynch is my Facebook page. And so I posted her video there last night. So that's where I got this. I thought it was pretty good. And so aluminum exposure is pretty significant here. 250 micrograms is doesn't sound like much, but when you inject it, it's quite a bit. Orally, you absorb about 1% of it, right? But you inject it, you got 100%. 100%. And the source of that 250 micrograms is Hep B, right at birth. And it keeps going. So basically you have 5 milligrams of aluminum by the time you're a year and a half old. So this was a really, really big kind of an aha moment when I saw her presentation. Remember the first doctor said, well, you didn't hear the video, it's only like 2 minutes long, but he basically said aluminum is safe. Aluminum isn't safe in people with chronic renal disease, and you need to be careful with it. Well, normal, healthy glomerular filtration rate, meaning the speed in which your kidneys are working, is about 90. 90 is normal. Look at an infant's. It's 39. So, and that doctor who's super pro-vaccine is said that, well, aluminum is a problem in chronic renal disease. Well, babies basically they don't have renal disease, they're just not up to speed yet. Their kidneys aren't up to speed yet, literally. They cannot filter as fast. If they can't filter as fast, and the primary rate to get rid of aluminum, the primary way to get rid of aluminum is to pee it out. So, but babies can't pee it out very fast because their kidneys aren't getting rid of it very fast. Normal is greater than 90. An infant at 2 to 8 days, which is when Hep B is given, is less than half of that. It's a third of it. So where does aluminum go? Brain. It's interfering with the genes. It's altering the gene expression. It's acting strongly. So if you gave that Hep B shot to a 12-year-old boy or girl, it's going to act way different on that kid compared to an infant. Way different. The genetic response, the cell danger response is going to be completely different. So I say, number one, aluminum is a big problem. Number two, the primary problem is the age in which we're giving vaccines. It's the age. Kids, the infants, their immune system is not ready for it at all. Too immature, does not handle it. And Judy Mukovits is an expert on this. So PubMed citation there if you want to look it up. Immune response, don't worry about the slide. I just want to show you all these letters and numbers. Interferon alpha, IL-1B, TNF-alpha, PGD-1, LI-6, IL-21. These are all cytokines. And cytokines are produced by genes. And things influence our genes. And aluminum influences various cytokines. Well, what if kids' genes were already triggered? We're already heavily, heavily influenced. It's a problem. So I told you I was going to talk about when you have multiple different genes and you're born with multiple genes that have a certain mutation. If you start looking at, say, 5 or 6 genes and they're all slightly slower, you stack those together, the response that person will have towards something is going to be very, very different than a person who has those 5 genes and they're all working really well. Make sense? Mm-hmm. So this research found that these cytokines, if they had this stack of a certain set of genes, I think it was 4 or 5 of them, they really, really responded with increased proliferation of inflammatory response. So these individuals, we're not even looking at aluminum here. We're not looking at folic acid, we're not looking at dairy antibodies, we're not looking at other chemicals in the environment, we're not looking at mold or bacterial infections, We're just looking at how they are genetically programmed. And they are genetically programmed to have their immune system really react strongly. On the flip side, the same researchers looked at the same genes, but different variations. Same genes, different variations, put them together as a haplotype. They had a very strong anti-inflammatory response. Very strong. So does every kid who gets vaccinated have a problem? No. A lot of them do. One in 160? Okay, we can't blame everything on vaccines, but it's yet another insult. It's one more thing that the genes have to tolerate. It's one more cell danger response. Are all babies born with vitamin D in sufficient levels? No. Are some babies born with really low vitamin D? Yes. Are some babies born sick already with viruses or bacteria or bad bacteria or a lack of a microbiome because they were C-section? Yes. So these are all compounding factors, right? All of them. So let's look specifically, because let's just keep it simple, and let's do kind of what standard conventional medicine does, and look at one thing and how it affects another one thing. Okay, so let's just look at how aluminum impacts particular genes. And let's see what these particular genes are and what would happen if this was the only thing out of the things that we already discussed. This was the only change that happened in the body. And would it be good or not? Could we say that aluminum was okay to give? Let's take a peek. All right, there's that MTR gene. Remember, it could be born dirty. All genes could be born dirty, i.e. with inherited slightly slower or faster from your mom and dad, or it can get dirty from the environment. What do you see there in purple? AL. AL, aluminum. Aluminum slows this particular gene down. Well, this gene, is this gene important? Well, everybody's concerned about MTGFR, okay? Everybody's focusing on MTGFR, including me. You know, so MTGFR, its job is to make methylfolate, but methylfolate can't even get in there if aluminum is blocking it, right? So that is one reason why you can't say, oh, you're medically exempt because you don't, because you have MTGFR and you go ahead and get vaccinated if you don't. That's not sound advice. It doesn't work that way. Even in the absence of MTGFR, everyone's methionine synthase gene, everyone's MTR gene is slowed down from aluminum. 100%. Okay, that's one insult. So there it is again. So this was the folate pathway. So this is folate metabolism. And this is the methylation cycle. Don't worry about all the circles and diagrams and all the flashy arrows. Just focus on that one particular gene, and aluminum slows it down. Okay, I don't have it written on here, but it's the same gene. This is an older pathway. When I find new research that supports it, I add it. Okay? So this is an older one. So what happens if this gene isn't working very well? If MTR is, say, now working slowly, what's going to happen to homocysteine? What do you think? It'll go up or down? It'll go up. Okay? So if this gene can't work, its job is to process homocysteine to get it into methionine, but aluminum is there. You know, I don't have it written. Oh, wait, there it is. Yeah, it's right there. Phew, thank you. So it's trying to get through, but MTR is busy dealing with aluminum. Okay? It's dealing with that cell danger response. Homocysteine is not what it's caring about right now. It can't handle the aluminum. That's what it's working on. And it's going to keep working on it until the aluminum levels drop. But what if they can't drop? What if the kidneys are not getting rid of it fast enough because it's a baby? Right? So what if the homocysteine level's already high because the infant has a MTGFR problem too and they don't get enough methylfolate? What if they have dairy antibodies? What if they have folate transport problems? And they can't transport folate very well. And they have this issue. Okay? You guys get my point? So, here's another crazy diagram, but G6PD, very, very important gene in the human body. Extremely important. If you have G6, glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase genetic disorder, you have to stay away from vitamin C. You cannot eat fava beans. You have to be very, very careful. Otherwise, your blood cells can basically blow up and you die. Okay? So, aluminum slows this gene down, just like G6PD mutation does. Its job is to, well, G6PD has a job to do, but when you're born with a G6PD inherited deficiency, it can't work. Aluminum slows it down too. And standard medicine wants to find one particular gene, like the warfarin metabolizing gene, and say, okay, you have this one particular gene, we have to alter how much warfarin you get. But they're not looking at haplotypes. They're not looking at multiple gene combinations to see, oh, you have an inflammatory haplotype, or you have an anti-inflammatory haplotype. They're not looking at the epigenetics, the environment of the baby either. They're not looking if they're having folic acid, if they have dairy antibodies, if they have homocysteine, low vitamin D, mold, current infection. They don't care. They don't care. That's a problem. So G6PD, its job, one of them, is to recycle your body's number one antioxidant, which is called glutathione, right here. Okay? So glutathione is right here. When it gets used up, it becomes damaged. It has to go through this gene here. But it can't go through this gene unless this is available. So see what already you're seeing how other genes rely on other genes. It's a partnership. Genes require other genes so they can do work. So this gene is being bombarded, G6PD, with aluminum. Your glutathione is getting damaged. As your glutathione levels drop, your immune system becomes way more reactive. And what happens if the baby's already born with low glutathione? Dr. Jill James's research, and she's shown that women who aren't pregnant and they have low glutathione levels during pregnancy and they have high homocysteine during pregnancy, they are at risk of having an autistic child goes up by about 70 times. Just those two alone, low glutathione and high homocysteine. And she said Sam-Saw ratio, but I'm just going to make it simplified and I'm going to say homocysteine. So low glutathione and high homocysteine increases the risk of autism dramatically. And then you inject aluminum into the newborn child at birth, and if the mother's glutathione levels are low and her homocysteine levels are high, what are they in the baby? The same. The same. Most likely. We're not done. SOD, superoxide dismutase, its job is to get rid of a really, really nasty free radical called superoxide. And it converts it into hydrogen peroxide. But it can't do that when it's dealing with aluminum. Okay? And again, this is an older one. I have a poster on my wall in my office. And I, right before I came here, I looked on my poster with the most up-to-date, and aluminum was on there. Okay? So as my research team and myself, again, we keep adding to this. So aluminum slows this one down, and aluminum slows this down. This also gets rid of hydrogen peroxide. Yes, your body makes hydrogen peroxide, which is basically a way to get rid of pathogens. But once it's done getting rid of pathogens, it wants to neutralize that hydrogen peroxide and turn it into inert water. But aluminum slows these three major antioxidant supportive genes down. So if these are not working well, inflammatory response is way higher. And we're just talking aluminum here. That's it. I'm not even adding genetic variations. There's genetic variations here, here, and here. And all genes, basically. And here's a big one. DHPR is also slowed by aluminum significantly. Its job is to turn damaged biopterin into useful biopterin. Okay? So what is biopterin? Who cares? Well, do you know about dopamine, norepinephrine, epinephrine, serotonin, melatonin, nitric oxide? All these things require Bioptrin. Every single one. If you don't have Bioptrin, your dopamine, your norepinephrine, your epinephrine, your serotonin, your melatonin, and your nitric oxide levels are down big time. So neurotransmitter production, neurotransmitter chemicals are really, really affected by this. And aluminum, we know already, is associated with Parkinson's, various neurological disorders, dementia, Alzheimer's, ALS, you name it, autism. So again, I just wanted to show you one example, because everybody's saying aluminum is fine. It's not fine. So regardless of genetic mutations, let's say your child was born with zero genetic variations, none. But your pregnancy wasn't the best, and then your baby was also struggling with a current viral infection, maybe you're remediating mold in your home, maybe you had difficulty breastfeeding because you were stressed out from the mold remediation, so you had to give a formula, and you tried desperately to find a good formula, but you couldn't find one, so your baby is getting a slightly inferior formula, which makes you more stressed out. These are the genes of chronic disease. Okay? The role of your particular gene had a job to do, and it can't do it because it's dealing with something else. The particular gene's job was to seat the rider to get from point A to point B very quickly. Okay? But it was loaded with bricks, or loaded with aluminum, or loaded with folic acid, or dairy antibodies, and it could not do its original job. Okay? So these are what your genes are looking like. They just can't process what they need to do. They can't do their usual job. Never mind that this is a very ingenious way to transport bricks, right? So that aside, I just like, you know, just think of this as a receptor on the cell, right? So this is the cell receptor, and think of all these as aluminum or folic acid or dairy antibodies, and it really wants to bind this guy's bum on the seat, but it can't because the receptors are all gummed up. Make sense? So you get rid of these things, then you can actually use the bike for what it's worth. And after he probably unloads all those bricks, he probably hops on and rides back to go get more. Yes?
We'd like to move to Q&A.
Okay.
If that works for you.
Yes, it does. So I'll just go through here. What I showed you is most important. Okay? So glad we got that done. Autism, it's a plethora of issues. Okay, this is a really good paper. It's just a plethora of issues of leaky guts and immune system disorders. Maternal infection or autoimmune diseases have been suspected. Maternal infection. Not infant, not baby, maternal. Okay? So if a woman during pregnancy has an infection during the first trimester, the risk of tongue tie goes way up. Way up. And now pregnant women are getting the flu shots at, you know, right when they're pregnant. It's like, oh, you need a flu shot. Bam. Say no. Say no. And a good friend of mine and colleague, Dr. David Berger, practices in Florida. He works with autistic children, and he runs labs on them all the time. He's finding all sorts of issues. He said no one lab looks the same in these autistic kids. They're all different. And a mother of the child says, you know, my doctor won't order these labs that I want to get done. Can you order them? He's like, no, I can't do that. I'm a pediatrician. She came back. She goes, no, I really, really want you to do it. It's fine. I'll do it. And he was going over the labs later of this woman's kid and saying, you know, here are all the things that we need to work on. And then the woman goes, those are my labs. He's like, oh, wait a second. So he pulled up the kid's labs. They looked the same. Autistic child's labs look the same as the mother's. And that's what Dr. Jill James is proving too. Is autism genetic? No, it's not. Very, 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 very rarely is it genetic. Like 1% of the time. 522 genes have been reported with autism. but it's mainly epigenetic, which is what I showed you earlier, of aluminum and folate receptor issues, so on. Infections cause a lot of issues. Infections increase inflammation, okay? So vaccines also trigger inflammation. They're supposed to. So I'm gonna, so I already did all these things. Folic acid, remember I talked about how important Biopterin was? Okay, folic acid, alterations in pH 2, so bad Biopterin to good Biopterin. The addition of folic acid inhibited the conversion to Biopterin considerably. Wow, right, another public health issue. 100-fold lower amount, okay? So good Biopterin just plummeted when you increase the level of folic acid, and it didn't take much. Look how much folic acid was used. Biopterin levels tanked. Number one recommendation I have for you all today that's very simple to clean your genes is avoid things. Avoid extra work, avoid extra food, and avoid folic acid. So this is a really good spot to stop because I want you to remember this, and I'll open it up to questions.
Okay, Dr. Lynch, what we'd like to do is take questions from the audience here and then alternate with some people who are being streamed to live.
Okay,
so,
sounds good.
Yeah, any questions? Go ahead and raise your hand.
Hey,
right down here.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry.
Okay. Okay.
I just wanted you to re-talk about IDO1 and vaccines and pregnancy that you talked about.
You say that again, sorry.
IDO1. Can you talk about that a little bit, getting vaccines in pregnancy and how we want that to run properly to decrease immune response in pregnancy? Is that the point?
Yeah, so this particular gene here is IDO1, and its job during pregnancy is to take your tryptophan during pregnancy and calm the immune response so the baby doesn't get aborted, okay? So the baby is a foreign object to a woman during pregnancy. And so the immune system has to be down-regulated, and this pathway down-regulates the immune system, okay? So it's a great pathway to have during pregnancy, but I think this pathway is also associated with postpartum depression as well, because it depletes your tryptophan. And if you follow the arrows, tryptophan goes this way for immune suppression and other things. But if you follow this way, 5-HTP goes to serotonin, which is, you get SSRIs, right? So I think postpartum depression is also linked to this pathway. But yes, immune suppression is a natural occurring phenomenon during pregnancy. And so women get sick during pregnancy, and then the baby can get viral exposures as well, and bacterial sickness, and also depletes vitamins and minerals from her because of the infection. And if the babies are sick, never vaccinate your child when they're sick. Ever, 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 ever vaccinate your kid when they're sick. Yeah.
I just have a quick question about, I've heard that there are physical manifestations that can mean that you may have an MTHFR.
Yes.
And I'm wondering how much truth there is to like tongue ties, lip ties, sacral dimples, etc. Things that I've heard.
Yeah, that's a great point. So there are physical manifestations which show that you have certain genetic anomalies. I will say that for the most part, I would refrain from saying they're mainly genetic to saying that they're epigenetic. I would say that they are showing signs that the genes are dirty or were dirty, whether it's because of a genetic polymorphism or variant, or it's because the gene wasn't able to work as well as needed to, or the mother didn't have the necessary nutrients during pregnancy. So for MTHFR, so you've got anything that's midline. So you could have tongue tie, lip tie, cleft palate, you could have hypospadias, you could have congenital heart defects, you could have spina bifida, neural tube defects, you could have lack of a skull, and then you're not gonna live. You could have extra nipples. So all of these things are associated with methylation issues. So pregnancy, folic acid was recommended in higher mountains during pregnancy because there's so much cell growth, right? So you've got yourself to take care of if you're the woman, you've got the whole developing new organ, the placenta, and you have the developing baby. So yeah, you need a lot more nutrients on board. So if you're taking a one-a-day prenatal, I know it's convenient, but you have three things you're supporting, yourself, the placenta, the baby, and your future grandkids at the same time. So make sure you're getting a good prenatal.
Okay. Sorry, I wanted to ask a question from somebody online. For Sarah Young, she's asking, what would you recommend for a child regarding vaccines when the mother has no MTHFR defect or family history? And then it ends there.
Yeah, so again, we can't base vaccination recommendations based upon one single gene. And I hope I made that point clear, right? We have to look at how the pregnancy is going, how the environment is. And you can run a genetic test and see, but what's most important is the environment that is going on, the current health of the child, the health of the mother. If the health of the mother during pregnancy was difficult, then the health of the baby is difficult as well. And you can't really tell, because babies, they might just cry and whine. They don't really whine, they cry, and they cry anyway. They might cry more, but you don't really know if it's a problem. So if the mother is super, the mother's super sick or you were super sick during pregnancy, then I would say likelihood that your baby isn't really thriving is also pretty high risk.
Single dose vaccines have recently been banned, is my understanding, on a national global level. Given that when you have aluminum and mercury, i.e. vaccine soup, does that put a whole nother spin of the dynamic on dirty genes?
Mm, big time, yeah, because now you have an additional, so the question is, some vaccines have if you inject the baby with aluminum and mercury, does that have another spin? Yeah, because now your other genes that are really, really important are slowed by mercury, right? So I showed you some aluminum ones, and that's just ones that I know from finding in research. There's many more. And now mercury is other genes that are super important because genes communicate with each other and they have different jobs to do. So yeah, when you introduce mercury, it's another insult for sure.
Follow-up question? Mm-hmm. Have you heard about vaccines being put in food?
I have not. But I don't specialize in vaccines, so I can't say that's true or not.
Thank you.
When I was pregnant, I found out I have MTHFR, and I haven't done further testing. We need to look at the epigenetics and not just the panel, but if I want to do testing for myself and my family, would you recommend going through 23andMe, or I've heard Maximize Genetics is good. Do you have one that you prefer?
Yeah, so what genetic test to use, basically, I still recommend 23andMe, the cheaper version.
Ancestry one?
Yeah, just the cheaper one. You don't have to go crazy. You can look at the health reports that they offer, and if they mean something to you, go ahead. Mm-hmm. I don't think they're that important.
Right.
So you can just get the cheaper one, and you can run it through various raw data machinery programs. I have one called Stratagene, and there's other ones as well. But I just really caution you when you export the raw data from your 23andMe test, if you're going through a report and they're recommending vitamins and minerals and supplements, that I would frown upon that because they cannot have any idea of what supplements that you need, and they're making guesses from that. And Maximize Genetics, I don't know. I know that they have some tests, but it's or some genes. It's decent, but it's not as thorough.
Okay, and then so say we go through that process and then we put it through Stratagene, then do we want to look mostly at environment, or how would we take our data and apply it for optimum wellness?
Yeah, so let's say you get your 23andMe back and you run it through Stratagene, right? So this is what Stratagene looks like. So you do both.
Okay.
You do both. So basically, I really like the combination of the book Dirty Genes with Stratagene. But if you're scared of ordering genetic test, of what that's going to open for you, because you kind of look under the hood and see what you're made out of, literally. And if that scares you, then don't do it, okay? But if you're curious and you want to know more, go ahead and do it, because what you find is you find that this individual here has a faster MAO-A, this one has an slightly faster or slower speed, well, actually intermediate speed, and here is okay, and this one is faster. So you learn the speeds in which your genes work, and then you add things like, oh, I'm vitamin B2 deficient, the FAD is vitamin B2, you learn that, oh, I'm vitamin B2 deficient, and maybe I'm not clearing my serotonin because I take 5-HTP, and I get a headache from 5-HTP. It makes me worse, more irritable and angry. So despite being born with a faster MAO-A, that 5-HTP was recommended by another genetic report to take it because you have a fast MAO-A, but you're riboflavin deficient. So your serotonin is building up and it can't get out. Make sense? Because vitamin B2 is necessary for this gene to work. Yes, it works naturally faster. You're born with a slightly faster gene. But if you don't have the necessary vitamin to make that go, it's slow. Right? So that's what I mean by becoming born dirty and then acting dirty.
Can I have one more little follow-up? I was curious if you have thoughts on vaccines in relation to histamine. And if you think that ties into the explosion of allergies.
Yeah, so vaccines definitely tie into the explosion of allergies. 100%. Yeah, 100%.
I'm not sure if you get into this in your book, but I'm part of a support group of people who are using a certain product for detox, and it's really helping with heavy metal detoxification, and we're seeing kids with autism that aren't speaking within 2 weeks of using this product are talking, and it's amazing. And so I'm wondering, what you talk about in terms of cleaning our genes and what you recommend for chelation and other detox programs?
Yeah, so what I recommend for detoxification programs in the book Dirty Genes, I recommend avoidance, number one. Avoidance of chemicals, avoidance of your genes having to do work is easier than getting them out. Okay, that aside, we all have, every one of us in this room has chemicals in us. A lot of them. Hundreds and hundreds of them. And so we need to get them out somehow. So second recommendation I have is sauna. Sauna is fantastic. And in avoidance, number one, filter your air, filter your water, eat organic. If you're not going to eat organic, because it's expensive, I get that. Just don't buy strawberries, peaches, and all these other things if you're not going to get them organic. So Environmental Working Group, EWG.org, buy the Clean 15 and avoid the Dirty Dozen. So you can go to EWG.org and you can download their little card, or you can put their app on your phone. In terms of supplementation for detoxifying, yeah, I think it's great. Liposomal glutathione is a big one for me. But also eat liver detoxification foods. Eggs are really high cysteine. You have beets. Cruciferous vegetables are also really good. So these are all fantastic. Those are the main ones I would focus on. I do not get into chelation or anything in the book. I strongly believe that needs to be done by experts and professionals.
Question in relation to the sauna. How did you know if your pathways are clogged? If you're using a sauna, how do you know that your pathways are working, that you are actually detoxing?
Okay, so how do you know if your pathways are detoxing while you're in the sauna? So if you get in a sauna and it's a moderate heat, not too bad, and you just get in there for a few minutes and you start to get really kind of funky feeling, kind of lightheaded, maybe a headache, you're just not feeling right, your detoxification pathways are not what they need to be. Gary, you need to get out. You're done. Or their detoxification pathways they're working, but they're so inundated because you've mobilized stuff from your fats, and maybe you're electrolyte deficient, maybe you're glutathione deficient, and they can't handle that load. So you need to get out. Never, ever, ever push yourself to a certain time in the sauna. Don't set the timer for 15 minutes and sit there and go, God, 5 more minutes. I got this. No, don't be macho. Get out. Okay? Get out.
I was just wondering, so the vaccines can contribute to, like, damaging the genes, from what you're saying. So is that gene damage then heritable by the next generation?
question. So are you saying that your genes get damaged from vaccines, and is that going to translate on to the next generation? So this is a field called translational epigenetics, which is an emerging, exciting field. An example of this is the famine that occurred in Ireland and England years and years ago, and women who were pregnant didn't have access to food. Okay, they didn't have access to food, and so the baby didn't have much access to food, and their genes function altered a bit. So now these babies are born into the environment ready to go to have very little food. Okay, they're going to be surviving in a low food environment. But the famine was over. Famine was over, they're eating all this stuff, but they have thrifty genes. They didn't need much food. Now they're obese and they're diabetic because these are genes that were really, really good at conserving calories and didn't need much, but now we're gluttons. So that's one. So I don't know if vaccines hurt our genes long term. I don't know if that's been looked at, but I do know they definitely dirty them. I'm hoping that's the whole point of dirty genes, is we can wipe them clean, right? Clean them up and move forward. But yes, you will translate that child as they grow up. If the aluminum isn't out or their epigenetic tags are altered, they will pass on potentially those problems to their kid, especially if it's a woman. You know, men is finding out to be a big issue too during pregnancy, but a lot more has to be found out with that.
We have to take a break now.
Okay.
Yeah. So I want to say thank you to Dr. Lynch for. We're going to take about a 10-minute break, and I want to tell the people on Facebook and everybody here too, I'm very sorry if we didn't get your questions, but what we will try to do is go back later, gather them, email you, and see if we can get some of those answers.
Yeah, if I may, go ahead and go. So if you have questions on Facebook, just post them away. If you're here and I haven't gotten your question, go to the Facebook page and post your question, and I'll answer them later.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Yeah.
Very much. Okay. Thank you.